Over the past century, more than 102,000 Australians have lost their lives in wartime service. The following Roll of Honour represents a small number of those who lost their lives during the First World War. From the sinking of the AE-1 in 1914 to the armistice of 11th November 1918.
Norman Leslie Steele, No. 1 Squadron, Australian Flying Corps, died of wounds in Palestine, 20th of April 1917, age 21, no known grave. Eric Ray Smith, 6th Battalion, died of illness at Gallipoli, 22nd of August 1915, age 21, buried at sea.
John Martin Fisher, 7th Battalion, died of wounds at Gallipoli, 9th of August 1915, age 24, buried at sea. Hugh Robert Fegan, 14th Battalion, died of wounds at Gallipoli, 28th of August 1915, age 28, buried at sea.
Jack Stanley Brazel, No. 1 Squadron, Australian Flying Corps, killed in action in Palestine, 25th of June 1917, aged 28, no known grave. Robert David Moffat, HMAS Australia, died of wounds at Bitterpucca, New Britain, 12th of September 1914, aged 20, buried at sea.
Robert Francis Perry, 7th Battalion, missing in action in France, presumed dead, 19th of July 1916, age 39, no known grave. Arthur Rupert Fulton, 7th Battalion, killed in action at the Battle of Fromelles, 19th of July 1916, age 22, no known grave.
Donald MacLeod, 37th Battalion, missing in action at Passchendaele, presumed dead, 12th of October 1917, age 19, no known grave. Richard Graham, 1st Battalion, Imperial Camel Corps, killed in action in Palestine, 19th of April 1917, age 23, no known grave.
James O'Donnell, 12th Battalion, killed in action at Ypres, 5th of October 1917, age 19, no known grave. Edward Rawls, 51st Battalion, killed in action at Passchendaele, 26th of September 1917, age 19, no known grave.
Cyril Thomas Robin, 58th Battalion, missing in action in Belgium, presumed dead, 27th of September 1917, age 22, no known grave. Thomas Hewson, No. 4 Squadron, Australian Flying Corps, killed in action in France, 7th of July 1917, age 22, no known grave.
Lancelot Charles Blackall, 4th Light Horse, killed in action in Palestine, 4th of May 1918, aged 37, no known grave. Alexander Stewart Burton, BC, 7th Battalion, killed in action at Lone Pine, Gallipoli, 9th of August 1915, aged 22, no known grave.
Thomas Wyburn Biddlecombe, HMS Q-27, killed in action off the coast of Ireland, 13th of March 1917, aged 36, buried at sea. Richard Martin, 47th Battalion, killed in action in France, 28th of March 1918, aged 26, no known grave.
Arthur Norman Allen, 58th Battalion, missing in action at Polygon Wood, presumed dead, 6th of October 1917. 1917. Age 21, no known grade. James Morrison Rind, 60th Battalion. Missing in action in France, presumed dead, 19th of July, 1916. Age 28, no known grave.
Russell William Gibson, 1st Light Horse. Killed in action at Gallipoli, 7th of August, 1915. Age 21, no known grave. Hamish James McNabb, 7th Battalion. Killed in action at Gallipoli, 25th of April, 1915. Age 19, no known grave.
Alfred Williamson, 14th Battalion. Missing in action in France, presumed dead. 11th of April, 1917. Age 23, no known grave. William Conway, 13th Battalion. Missing in action at Pozieres, presumed dead. 30th of August, 1916. Age 28, no known grave.
Harold Boyd Wanless, 14th Battalion, killed in action at Polygon Wood, 26th of September, 1917, age 25, no known grave. Charles Henry Bear, 7th Battalion, killed in action at Fromelles, 19th of July, 1916, age 21, no known grave.
Alwyn Stanley Baker, 8th Light Horse, killed in action at the Neck, Gallipoli, 7th of August 1915, aged 35, no known grave. Edgar Robert Adams, 8th Battalion, missing in action at Gallipoli, presumed dead, 25th of April 1915, aged 18, no known grave.
Ernest Holsby Mason, 24th Battalion, killed in action at Pozieres, 12th of August 1916, aged 23, no known grave. William Palmer Ritchie, 2nd Battalion, killed in action in Belgium, 12th of October 1917, aged 19, no known grave.
George Henry Grace, 59th Battalion, killed in action at Flubeau, 19th of July, 1916, age 22, no known grave. Ernest Henry Netherby, 4th Light Horse, killed in action in Palestine, 2nd of May, 1918, age 27, no known grave.
George Stewart, 10th Battalion, killed in action at Pozieres, 19th of August, 1916, age 28, no known grave. Jack Jarman, HMAS AE1, killed when the AE1 sank off New Britain, presumed dead, 14th of September, 1914, age 21, buried at sea.
Francis Joseph Betts, 42nd Battalion, died of wounds at Messines, 22nd of January 1918, age 23, buried at sea. David Samuel Anderson, 54th Battalion, killed in action at Fromelles, 19th July 1916, age 24, body discovered and reburied at Pheasant Wood in 2010.
Reginald Albert Sharp, HMAS Sydney, died of wounds in action against the Emden, 9th of November 1914, age 22, buried at sea. Norman Wakefield Folks, 14th Battalion, killed in action at Gallipoli, 8th of August 1915, age 26, no known grave.
Stanley Dow, 48th Battalion, missing in action in Belgium, presumed dead, 12th of October, 1917, aged 23, no known grave. Joseph Stratford, 9th Battalion, killed in action at Gallipoli, 25th of April, 1915, aged 34, no known grave.
Reginald George Fuller, 4th Field Ambulance, killed in action at Messines, 8th of June 1917, aged 20, no known grave. Charles Ernest Wigg, 38th Battalion, missing in action at Passchendaele, presumed dead, 13th of October 1917, aged 26, no known grave.
Eric Gentle Roy, 8th Battalion, killed in action at Gallipoli, 7th of August 1915, aged 20, no known grave. Henry Evans, 12th Battalion, killed in action at Gallipoli, 25th of April 1915, aged 20, no known grave.
Thomas Anderson White, 10th Battalion, died of wounds at Gallipoli, 25th of April 1915, age 28, buried at sea. Frank Charles Watson, 10th Battalion, missing in action at Messines, presumed dead, 8th of June 1917, age 20, no known grave.
Royden Hoadley Pinney, 25th Battalion, killed in action at Pozieres, 29th of July 1916, age 32, no known grave.
Edith Blake, Queen Alexandra's Imperial Military Nursing Service, killed when the hospital ship Glenart Castle was sunk by a German U-boat, 26th of February 1918, age 32, buried at sea.
New Zealand-born James Wilson was once described as possessing a striking personality. He had done all manner of jobs and travelled widely before the war. He enlisted specifically to minister to the men of the mining companies on the Western Front. In September 1916, surveying the scene on the Somme and with deep admiration for the men with whom he served, he wrote, "All of these boys have been through experiences that are indescribable in horror, bearing themselves like heroes. How I love and admire these boys and pray that they may get through. How my heart aches for those whose boys are sleeping in the dust here all around us. But make no mistake, there are no cold footers in this group. We are in to see the thing through. And if we return, as we pray God we may, we shall love you and our homes and our dear old Australia far better than ever. As for all those who sleep, oh, how we honour them. You should see how their graves are cared for. The boys are always at work there. Our eyes are often filled with tears here. And our hearts go out to those who mourn. But they've done their work now and laid down their lives for their friends." Wilson was invalided home in 1917 and left the ministry in 1920 to go into politics. He died in 1927 at Randwick Hospital in Sydney.
Thank you, Lance Corporal Watts. The commemorative service will commence shortly. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Welcome to the commemorative service at the Australian National Memorial at Villers-Bretonneux in northern France. Good evening also to the many Australians who may be watching this broadcast back home in Australia and elsewhere. We wish you were here with us among the quiet ghosts on the Western Front to pay our eternal gratitude for their sacrifice. I'm Major General Mark Kelly, the Repatriation Commissioner at the Australian Department of Veterans Affairs, and it is my great privilege to be your Master of Ceremonies for this morning's service to mark the 100th anniversary of the Armistice of the First World War. I will now broadly acknowledge our official guests. His Excellency, the Honourable Paul de Jersey AC, the Governor of Queensland, and Mrs. de Jersey. The Honourable Darren Chester MP, the Australian Minister for Veterans Affairs, the Minister for Defence Personnel, the Minister assisting the Prime Minister for the Centenary of Anzac, representing the Prime Minister. Monsieur Jean-Charles Giray, General Secretary of the Prefecture of the Somme, representing the Government of the French Republic. The Honourable Warren Snowden MP, representing the Leader of the Federal Opposition. Veterans, other distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a special mention also for all our young men and women serving in the Australian Defence Force, those in the Royal Australian Navy, the Australian Army, and the Royal Australian Air Force, the Australian custodians of the Anzac tradition. Wherever you are serving, we thank you for your service and we await your safe return. Here in this special place in the Somme Valley, where 100 years ago today, the guns fell silent at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month in 1918, which signalled that the war was over. For Australia, the First World War was the most costly in terms of deaths and casualties. From a population of fewer than 5 million people, over 400,000 men enlisted, more than 60,000 were killed, and over 150,000 were wounded. Today we gather to remember all those who served, all those we lost, and the families that they left behind. Our service today begins with the mounting of the catafalque party.
Catafalque party, quick, march! Party presents, ounce. Catapult party reverse. Catapult party slow. Party, rest on! Thank you.
His Excellency, Mr. Angus Mackenzie, the Australian Ambassador to UNESCO and the Deputy Head of Mission at the Australian Embassy in France, to welcome you here.
Aujourd'hui, en cette heure symbolique, je vous souhaite la bienvenue au Mémorial National Australien pour nous rappeler ensemble ce moment historique qui, 100 ans auparavant, a mis un terme à 4 ans de conflit mondial. Today, we Australians gather on the battleground to commemorate, along with friends of all nationalities, our loved ones who gave their lives during 4 years of conflict. En cette heure, il y a 100 ans même, si la joie affichait sur tous les visages, un voile venait les sombrir, un voile de souvenir d'un être cher tombé au combat. In the fields around us, when the sounds of war had faded, men were confronted with the cost. You would hardly think there are so many graves in the fields. Still, there are hundreds out there to come in yet, wrote 20-year-old Private William McBeath to his mother in May 1919. In 1 week, William's unit found the remains of 200 men killed in battle. Des milliers d'hommes et de femmes sont tombés, des milliers n'ont jamais revu leur famille et leur pays, et des milliers d'entre eux ont disparu à jamais. Seuls leurs noms restent gravés dans la pierre, marquant leur courage et leur valeur. On the memorial wall behind me are the names of more than 11,000 Australians who lost their lives in France and for more than a century have been missing in action. Soldats valeureux à jamais disparus, soldats inconnus, un de ces hommes est là pour nous les rappeler. Comme le soldat inconnu sous l'arc de triomphe, il veille sur eux et sur nous. Australia's unknown soldier, now at rest in the Australian War Memorial's Hall of Memory, was one of these men. Somewhere behind me, his name is inscribed. Unknown, he represents all those Australians who lost their lives in the Great War, and in the words of his memorial, he is one of those, and he is one of us. Le soldat inconnu apporte à chacun une part de cet être cher disparu, il réconforte. En nous rassemblant ici, aujourd'hui, nous ranimons cette flamme et rendons à la lumière s'est disparu dans l'ombre. In coming to France to commemorate the centenary of the Armistice, we honour not only those who died, but those families too who were never able to mourn their loved ones here where they fell in the service of their country. Nous les oublions jamais, lest we forget.
Thank you, Ambassador. I now invite Air Vice Marshal Warren McDonald, AMCSC, Chief of Joint Capabilities for the Australian Defence Force, to deliver a call to remembrance.
On this date, at this hour in 1918, silence descended across the Western Front. In one instant, the fighting that had raged since August 1914 ended. An Australian woman, staying in Villers-Bretonneux in the months after the armistice, said, "It seemed like living in a graveyard." As he surveyed the Western Front in the aftermath, Sir Edwin Lutyens, the man who designed numerous memorials to the fallen, including the Australian National Memorial, before which we are gathered, described a ribbon of isolated graves, like a Milky Way across miles of country. This is a place of ghosts. For those who lived through the war years in Australia, the Western Front was a distant aberration. A place that could only be imagined. The graves of the fallen and the memorials to the missing were beyond the reach of their loved ones. Their loss left a terrible void, yet they remained an enduring presence. For bereaved families, the memories of their lost brothers, fathers, husbands, and sons lasted a lifetime. Their expressions of grief resonate today as they did a century ago. A woman whose brother was killed in action wrote, "Even if the dead were missing on earth, beyond the grave, they were somewhere, somewhere with God." People held on to the memory of the dead and hoped that in another realm they lived on. And it is those memories, images, and the gravity of their sacrifice that we must make live on. Today, I picture the ghosts of those fallen Australian soldiers moving slowly amongst us. Their movements not random, but deliberate. They know what they seek. We, as we sit, are unafraid and remain in respectful silence. As we watch them, it becomes apparent they seek out the men and the women who have lost a loved one in war. As they reach the women, they kneel beside them and hold their hands in a gesture that can only be fully understood by those who have lost, by those who have grieved. As for the men, they stand behind them and extend a warm hand and place it on a shoulder. It is of great comfort. Together, they all weep. We see some move lovingly towards the children in what begins as a gentle pace. However, long before they reach them, they stumble and fall to their knees, their chests heaving in sadness as they cradle their heads in their hands and mourn for what we at times take for granted, but for which they lost forever. Today, as we imagine the fallen once again walking this ground, Australians with their familiar accent and distinctive gait and their love of country, we must remember they gave us the gift of sacrifice, a gift that we must forever protect and honour. In the words of Charles Bean, "The Australian Imperial Force is not dead. That army of great-hearted men, as he called them, lives on in a nation's memory. And it is that very nation that thanks the gracious people of France who, for 100 years, have respected and honoured our fallen, lest we forget."
Thank you, Air Vice Marshal MacDonald. Our first commemorative address this morning will be delivered by the Honourable Darren Chester MP, the Australian Minister for Veterans Affairs.
Ladies and gentlemen, to those serving us in uniform and to those who served their nations in the past, may I offer a special welcome. Thank you for your service. And thank you to your families for supporting your service. Behind me are the names of 11,000 Australians who died in France in the Great War and have no known grave. When we read those names and thousands more on graves and cemeteries here in France, and the honour rolls and memorials in town centres and country halls back at home in Australia, we keep our promise. It's a promise to never forget the service and sacrifice of 416,000 Australians and more than 60,000 who never made it home to the country they loved and the country that loved them in return. But don't just see the names. Think of the stories behind them. They left behind wives, children, girlfriends, mums and dads, uncles and aunties, their best mates. Their loss cannot be quantified. But newspapers of the day quantified the heartbreak. Mort O'Loughlin published an in memoriam notice in the Age newspaper on the 28th of February 1918. It marked the first anniversary of the death of her eldest son, Captain Henry O'Loughlin, who was killed at Bapaume. Her poem, written in Henry's honour, is a window into the grief shared by so many mothers across the nation and the world. There came a shock, an awful pain, and the world has never seen the same. To have, to love, and then to part is the saddest story of the human heart. Did he whisper any name at the last, or breathe out a parting prayer? Where did they bury my darling one? Does anyone know or care? How much I loved you, God alone could see. Your death came such a blow to me. While you're sleeping, my love is nigh. If any miss you, dear Harry, it is I. As we remember, we can commit ourselves to respecting their service in all that we do today. We honour the fallen of the Great War by the way we choose to live in 2018. And it was Charles Bean, the official war correspondent to the Australian Imperial Forces, who wrote at the end of the Great War, "We are free to be happy again. 60,000 Australians bought us their happiness with their lives." But Bean also wrote that their fallen had given their love, given their lives grandly, cheerfully knowing the cause. He said, "Only by one means can we work out our thanks to them, by continuing the task which they were forced to drop when the bullet took them, and devoting our lives to make this country the happy, great and generous land whose future with their death they gave into our hands." There is no place on the planet more soaked in the sacrifice of Australian soldiers than here on the Western Front, and their actions defined a modern Australia. We owe them much more than a debt of gratitude. We owe them our determination, our resilience, our courage, and our combined humanity to protect their legacy and keep building our great nation. We must prove by our actions every day that they did not die in vain. As Prime Minister Billy Hughes said at the time, "Of their deeds, it's not necessary for me to speak. Of their valour, endurance and resource at Gallipoli, Pozieres, Bapaume and other famous fields, men still speak with awe." And Billy Hughes put our soldiers' sacrifice into perspective when he added, "Our heritage, our free institutions of government, all that we hold dear, are handed back into our keeping, stained with the blood of sacrifice." Surely not only we, their fellow citizens, but Australians throughout the ages will treasure forever the memories of those glorious men to whom the Commonwealth owes so much, and will guard with resolute determination the privileges for which they fought and suffered. Ladies and gentlemen, today we face a new threat, the threat of terrorism within our own nation. The bravery of those named on the walls behind me and those men and women who serve in our uniform throughout the world today stands in contrast to the cowards who seek to attack innocent citizens on our streets. It is the challenge of our time, and we must stand united. United in the defence of our hard-fought freedoms and our enduring national values of respect for human life, tolerance, equality, and a fair go for all. On this day, as we gather to mark the centenary of the armistice that ended the fighting of the Great War, we have the opportunity, in our moments of quiet reflection, to help set our nation's course for the next 100 years. within us all there is the capacity to serve, to help make a difference in our own community, in our great nation. So as we remember the fallen today, as we respect their sacrifice and honour their service, we can commit ourselves to that same spirit. For a century, we have kept our promise and we have remembered them, lest we forget.
Thank you, Minister. Our second commemorative address this morning will be delivered by Monsieur Jean-Charles Giray, General Secretary of the Prefecture of the Somme.
En ce 11 novembre 2018, toutes les villes et tous les villages de France commémorent la fin de la Première Guerre mondiale. Dans chaque ville et dans chaque village, sur la place où est érigé le monument en l'honneur des morts pour la France, le représentant de l'État s'apprête à lire, en ce moment même, un message du président de la République française pour célébrer ce 100e et historique anniversaire. À la demande du préfet de la Somme, Philippe de Mester, qui préside actuellement la cérémonie à Amiens, je tiens à vous préciser que si ce message s'adresse principalement aux soldats français, il a aussi une dimension universelle et nous incite à ne jamais oublier le sacrifice des jeunes hommes venus de pays souvent lointains et qui reposent à présent pour l'éternité au cœur de la terre de France. Parmi ces jeunes hommes, il y a vos fils australiens qui ont su faire preuve d'un courage et d'une abnégation qui ont marqué notre mémoire collective. Leur sang a scellé à jamais l'amitié entre nos deux peuples. Je leur dédie ce message du président de la République française. Un siècle que l'armistice du 11 novembre 1918 est venu mettre un terme au combat fratricide de la Première Guerre mondiale. À cet affrontement interminable, nation contre nation, peuple contre peuple, avec ses tranchées pleines de boue, de sang et de larmes, ces orages de feu et d'acier qui grondaient par tous les temps et déchiraient les ciels les plus calmes, ces champs de bataille éventrés et la mort omniprésente. Le 11 novembre 1918, un grand soupir de soulagement traverse la France. Depuis Compiègne, où l'armistice a été signé à l'aube, il se propage jusqu'aux champs de bataille. Le 11 novembre, enfin, après 4 interminables années de bruit et de fureur, de nuit et de terreur, les armes se taisent sur le front occidental. Enfin, le vacarme funeste des canons laisse place à la clameur allègre qui s'élève de volées de cloches en sonneries de clairons, d'esplanades de grandes villes en places de villages. Partout, on célèbre alors avec fierté la victoire de la France et de ses alliés. Nos poilus ne se sont pas battus pour rien. Ils ne sont pas morts en vain. La patrie est sauvée. La paix, enfin, va revenir. Pour commémorer la victoire, mais aussi pour célébrer la paix, nous sommes réunis dans nos communes, devant nos monuments aux morts, pour rendre hommage et dire notre reconnaissance à tous ceux qui nous ont défendus hier, mais aussi à ceux qui nous ont défendus aujourd'hui jusqu'au sacrifice de leur vie. Nous nous souvenons aussi de la souffrance et de l'honneur de tous ceux qui ont quitté leur terre et sont venus d'Afrique, du Pacifique et d'Amérique sur ce sol de France qu'ils n'avaient jamais vu et qu'ils ont pourtant vaillamment défendu. Nous nous souvenons de la souffrance et de l'honneur des 10 millions de combattants de tous les pays qui ont été envoyés dans ces combats terribles. Françaises, Français, nous sommes aussi unis en ce jour, dans la conscience de notre histoire et dans le refus de sa répétition. Car le siècle qui nous sépare des terribles sacrifices des femmes et des hommes de 14-18 nous a appris la grande précarité de la paix. Nous savons avec quelle force les nationalismes, les totalitarismes peuvent emporter les démocraties et mettre en péril l'idée même de civilisation. Nous savons avec quelle célérité l'ordre multilatéral peut soudain s'écrouler. Nous savons que l'Europe unie, forgée autour de la réconciliation de la France et de l'Allemagne, est un bien plus fragile que jamais. Vigilance, tel est le sentiment qui doit nous inspirer le souvenir de l'effroyable hécatombe de la Grande Guerre. Ainsi, serons-nous dignes de la mémoire de celles et ceux qui, il y a un siècle, sont tombés. Ainsi, serons-nous dignes du sacrifice de celles et ceux qui, aujourd'hui, font que nous nous tenons là, unis, en peuple libre. Vive l'Europe en paix, vive la République et vive la France.
Thank you, Monsieur Giray. I now invite Chaplain Peter Friend, the Director Chaplaincy at Headquarters Air Command of the Royal Australian Air Force, to lead us in a prayer of remembrance.
As we pause in reflection, people of faith turn their thoughts to prayers. If it is your desire, please join me as I pray in my tradition, or in silence, reflect in your own way. Let us pray. Eternal God, in this quiet and somber place, we pause at this moment to reflect and to remember before you the tragedy of the battles that occurred around this sacred memorial 100 years past. May those memories always remain poignant and fresh in our national memory. In those battles, Australian troops were far from home, protecting the lives and liberties of innocent people in peril. As we recall their legacy of devotion to duty and sacrifice for the security and welfare of others, make us a people zealous for peace. May we have the grace and determination to seek justice, mercy, and peace for all people, and so reflect your will in our world. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Padre. It is now time to reflect and to silently remember all those who have served and died in war. Please stand for the ode, which will be followed by the last post, 1 minute silence, and rouse. The ode will be recited by Warrant Officer Class 1 Brian Moore, the Regimental Sergeant Major Ceremonial for the Australian Defence Force. And the act of souvenir will be recited by Dr. Patrick Simon AO, the Mayor of Villers-Bretonneux.
They went with songs to the battle, they were young, straight of limb, true of eye, steady and aglow. They were staunch to the end against odds uncounted, they fell with their faces to the foe. They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
We will remember them.
Lest we forget.
Lest we forget.
Ils ne vieilliront pas, contrairement à nous qui aurons cette chance. Ils ne seront pas épuisés par l'âge ni condamnés par les années. À la tombée de la nuit et au petit matin, nous nous souviendrons d'eux. Nous nous souviendrons d'eux. Lest we forget.
Thank you.
Catapult party, shoulder, arms.
Please remain standing and join the band of the Royal Australian Air Force and the voices of Birrellee Choir in singing the hymn, Be Still My Soul.
Thank you.
please be seated. I now invite leading seaman Shane Rennie from the Royal Australian Navy of the Australian Defence Force to read the poem In Flanders Field, written over 100 years ago after the Second Battle of Ypres in 1915.
In Flanders fields the poppies blow, between the crosses row on row, that mark our place. And in the sky the larks still bravely singing, fly scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset's glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch. Be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Thank you, leading seaman Rennie. Wreaths will now be laid by official representatives to acknowledge the bond between Australia and France. The first wreath will be laid jointly by the Honourable Darren Chester MP on behalf of the government and the people of Australia, and Monsieur Jean-Charles Jarret, the General Secretary of the Prefecture of the Somme, on behalf of the government and the people of the French Republic. Next wreath will be laid on behalf of the people of Queensland by His Excellency the Honourable Paul de Jersey AC and Mrs. de Jersey. The next wreaths will be laid by the Honourable Warren Snowden MP on behalf of the Federal Opposition and Madame Christelle Yves on behalf of the Conseil Departemental de la Somme. The next wreaths will be laid on behalf of the state governments of Western Australia and New South Wales by the Honourable Peter Tinley AM MLA and the Honourable John Ajaka MLC. The next wreaths will be laid on behalf of the Australian Defence Force and the French Armed Forces by Air Vice Marshal Warren MacDonald, AMCSC, and Colonel Christophe Rayneux. The next wreaths will be laid on behalf of the people of Fouas and Villers-Bretonneux by Monsieur Bernard Brochot and Dr. Patrick Simon, AO. The next wreaths will be laid on behalf of the Commonwealth War Graves Commission, the Royal British Legion, and the Returned and Services League of Australia by Mr. Steve Arnold, Mr. Dennis McCarthy, and Mr. Arthur Bush. The final wreaths will be laid on behalf of all veterans of Australia, France, and all the other allied nations by Rear Admiral Ian Crawford, AO, RAN retired, and Captain Chris Nelson. Please stand for the national anthems of France and Australia.
Oh.
I now invite Chaplain Peter Friend to offer a final blessing.
Eternal God, as we depart this sacred place of remembrance, help us to learn from the costly sacrifices of the past. May we go forth as people who embrace justice, mercy, and hope, holding fast to all that is good and seeking such blessings in the lives of others. May we know your divine blessing in our life journey, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Padre. Please be seated. We began our service this morning with the mounting of the catafalque party, and now the catafalque party will be dismounted.
Catafalque party in wards, turn. Catafalque party, quick, march.
The final part of our service this morning will be the public wreath laying. If you have registered to lay a wreath or tribute, please commence making your way forward now. Could I ask everyone not laying a wreath to please remain in their places during this period, and for wreath layers to move to and from the memorial as described in your registration. I call first direct descendants of the First World War, followed by other government representatives not included in the official wreath laying, then regimental and unit X service organisations and associations, school groups, and finally members of the general public who registered. Wreaths will now be laid by the following people: Major General Liz Cosson, AMCSC, on behalf of her grandfather, John George Cosson, DCM, Miss Stephanie Brands and Rod Oliver, on behalf of the ABC and all war correspondents. Kerry Morley, Nee Statton, and Bill Morley, on behalf of Percy Clyde Statton and all 14 Tasmanian Victoria Cross recipients. Anne McAdam, on behalf of Norman Hillbrick. Ronald and Susan Judge, on behalf of Jesse and Alfred Judge. Richard and Brenda Thomas, on behalf of George Burrows and Australian Engineers. David Hamill and Pat Evatt, on behalf of Francis Evatt. Donna Sini, on behalf of Archibald McKellar. Robert Hunt, on behalf of William O'Halloran. Robert Bush, on behalf of Frank and Jules Bush. Kerry Bush, on behalf of Ernest Boyd. Michael McDonald, on behalf of Herbert Wilson. Jacqueline Groom, on behalf of the Independent Education Union of Australia. Jenny Blake, on behalf of Herbert and Morton Dobson, Stanley Hingston, Albert Ballam, Frederick and Leslie Clark, Harry and Leslie Robertson, and Frank Clark. Russell Sewell, on behalf of Ernest Sewell. Daphne Lyons, on behalf of Ernest Pittman. Bernard Denner and Marianne Van Dyke, on behalf of the Mildura RSL and George Williams. Rob Atkinson, David Martin and Brett Courtney, on behalf of the Australian Orthopaedic Associations. Gordon McCutcheon, on behalf of the McCutcheon and Lamont families. James Smith, Alex Gemmell, Billy Bootlin and Andrew Wright, on behalf of the Royal Scots Dragoon Guards Association. The 2018 Sadlier Stokes Prize winners from the Victoria School at Villers-Bretonneux. Julie Banfield, on behalf of Frank Banfield. Steve Morganti, on behalf of the Australian Air Force Cadets. Sherry Clark, on behalf of Frederick Booker. Sienna Carlisle Clark, on behalf of Edinburgh College. Melissa Roberts, on behalf of the Kuroi Pomona RSL. Brett Ardron, on behalf of the Ardron and Roberts families. Brian Foster, on behalf of James Foster. Michael Groom, on behalf of Rugby Australia. Roz and Terry Saunders, on behalf of Leslie Parkinson and Norman Kelly. Pamela Nee Postel and Christopher Howe, on behalf of Edgar Postel. John Lee, on behalf of the Lee family. Philip Stone Street, on behalf of Made Easy Tours. Judith Dwyer, on behalf of John Downer. Daryl Mills, on behalf of D.A. Diedrich of the 14th Battalion. Jane Fremantle and Ken Mason, on behalf of William Mason. Anne Sims, on behalf of the Crib Point RSL. Arthur Bush, on behalf of the French Consul General of Victoria. Colleen Kopp, on behalf of George Page. Diane Scott and Graham Osterfield, on behalf of Frank Christie. Craig Donaldson, on behalf of Robert Donaldson. The Duncan family, on behalf of William Duncan and the Innisfail RSL and community. Belinda Dinsey, on behalf of Frederick, Robert and George Dinsey. Ian Blaney, on behalf of the Geraldton City RSL. Chris and Lorraine Nielsen and the Dinium family, on behalf of Ernest Armstrong and Stanley Russell. Ron Rankmore, on behalf of Lewis McGee. Greg Pawley, on behalf of the Westpac Banking Corporation. Robert Stemp, on behalf of the Stemp and Herdsfield families. Linda Stemp, on behalf of the Woodlink State School, Queensland. Andrew Foster, on behalf of George Sutherland. Jade Trompetti, on behalf of all the diggers. Marlene Hick and Felicia Hick, on behalf of Charles Bowden and Edward Stewart. John Lakey and Virginia Robert, on behalf of our families. Rosemary Lane, on behalf of Edgar Lane. Brendan Britton, on behalf of the 5th Engineer Regiment. Janine Fakri, on behalf of Alan Russell, beloved brother of Isabel. Robin Smith, on behalf of the Smith, Sullivan and Ramsey families, in a tribute to John Ramsey. Philip Clark, on behalf of the Clark and Wiltshire families, in a tribute to Harold Wiltshire. Stephen Crinks, on behalf of Frank Crinks. Andrew Shute, on behalf of the Toowong RSL sub-branch. Stephen Walls, on behalf of all 14th Battalion Descendants Association. Belinda Dinsey, on behalf of the Dinsey, Burke and Gray families. Rose Mary Lane, on behalf of Edgar Murray Lane. Australian War Graves, on behalf of Aubrey Whittington. Ken Mason and Jane Fremantle, on behalf of William Mason. Margie and Megan Walsh, on behalf of Norman and Clary Temple. Chris and Lorraine Nielsen, on behalf of the Dinium family. Ilhami Getsisi, on behalf of Gallipoli, Turkey. Melissa Roberts, on behalf of the Kuroi and Pomona sub-branch of the RSL. Brett Ardron, on behalf of the Roberts and Ardron's families. Philippe Clebot, on behalf of all those with no known grave and our unknown soldiers. John Raynor, on behalf of the Catherine RSL. John North, on behalf of the Royal Australian College of Surgeons.
Matthew Hogarth, on behalf of the family of Lieutenant General Sir Joseph Talbot Hobbs, and Michael Foley, on behalf of the RSL sub-branch. The final tribute will be laid by Elise and Simon Watt of the Voices of Birralee Choir from Brisbane. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our service here at the Australian National Memorial at Villers-Bretonneux in the Somme Valley to commemorate the centenary of the Armistice of the First World War. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, for safety and security reasons, please remain in your location until after the official party has departed. Thank you and good morning.